random process is a function of two quantities. One is a sample space and another one is a time. So as I was saying, you can think of random process as an extension of a random variable with the inclusion of time. Okay. So you have to understand this particular diagram. Okay. So x1 of t, x2 of 3, x3 of t, and so on. Okay. So as I was saying, the notations you have to just understand, each x1 of t or x2 of t, they are all time functions because they are all the signals. You can think of them as signals varying with respect to time. They are also called as sample functions. They are also called as sample functions, or they are also called as ensemble members. Okay, so one more way of looking into random process is it's a collection of, or it's a family of, or ensemble of many time functions. Okay, so as I was saying, this is just naming convention. You can just remember these words. Okay, so they're all, I mean, like us, they're all kind of synonyms. So it's a collection of many time functions. So collection means you just have to put all the time functions in one group like this. So x1 of t, x2 of t, x3 of t. So they're all different time functions. And when you group all the things together, then that becomes a random process. Okay. So that's the way, that's also one more way of looking into the definition of random process. Okay. Yes, so one more important thing that we have seen yesterday was what happens if you freeze or if you fix one dimension of a random process. Let me tell you again, as I was saying, random process is a two-dimensional quantity. Time is a first dimension and sample space is a second dimension, right? So since I have a quantity which is varying with respect to two variables, two independent variables, I say two dimensions. Okay. The interesting thing is what happens if you fix or freeze? Fix or freeze. Both convey the same thing. What happens if you fix or freeze one quantity? Okay. So let us see one by one. If I freeze sample point, then what happens? Which means you go to the previous diagram, and in the previous diagram, if I assume that my sample space, I have performed the experiment and the sample space outcome is S1, then what happens? Then the random process simply becomes one time function, because I'm telling you that the sample point is S1, and hence the function that corresponds to S1 is X1 of t, which means the random process is now just a function of the time, because sample space is fixed at a particular point, S equal to S1. Am I clear? So that's the first case where if you freeze or fix one particular, freeze sample point. Okay. So you can see that here, random process becomes a time function when the sample space is fixed at a particular value. The second case is what, so this, if you freeze, then it becomes a function of only the time. Okay. The second case is what happens if you freeze time. Okay. So you can see that here, I have drawn one dotted line here at a particular value t equal to t1. So what has happened? If I freeze time to a particular value t equal to t1, then x of t comma s becomes x of t1 comma s. Now you can see here that time is fixed, right? Then the random process is now a function of only the sample space. Now you know that a thing which is, or a quantity which is function of only sample space, is nothing but a random variable, right? So a random variable, random process becomes a random variable when time is fixed at a specific value. Okay, so these two things are very, very important. to visualize a random process. A random process, as I was saying, it's a two-dimensional quantity. And what happens if you freeze one dimension? Okay. And this question I've asked you yesterday also. What happens if you freeze both quantities? If you freeze both time and sample space, then what you get is just one real number. Just one real number. Okay. So this is what we have seen in yesterday's class. Today's class will directly jump into the classification of random process. Okay. Classification of, see, as soon as the class is over, I sincerely request you to go through the textbook, okay? So the standard, the textbook that I follow is Peebles. This is the textbook that is given in your syllabus itself. It is, already I have circulated a soft copy of the textbook in your WhatsApp groups. Or I think I have given to your CRs. Get it from them. It's Peebles. Okay. I think P10 Z Peebles or P10 M Peebles, whatever. Okay. So this is the textbook that I am following. So what I am telling you is, as soon as the class is over, I request all of you to please go through the topics that I have covered in that particular class. Then only there will be a continuity. Then only you will understand. Especially as I was saying, so classification of random processes. If you remember, we have classified random variables also. How did we classify random variables? Can someone tell me what are the different types of random variables we have? Anyone? Classify random variables, man.
Discrete, continuous, mixed.
Very good, very good. So it's majorly, we can, the major classification, we can say discrete and continuous, right? So as I was saying in yesterday's class, random variable is a function of sample space, right? So if x is random variable, then actually we have to write x of s, but we are writing it as simply x. We are ignoring s from the notation. That's fine. So based on whether the sample space is discrete or continuous, we have classified the random variables also into either discrete or sample continuous. So continuous random variable and discrete random variable. But coming to the random processes, a random process capital X of T comma S is a two-dimensional quantity, right? Or it is varying with respect to two quantities. What are they? They are time and sample space. Okay. Or I say they are time and random variable. Both of them, when I say sample space or the random variable, both convey the same thing, because random variable is a function of sample space. Okay. So let us classify them. It is, first I'll just classify them and then we'll see one by one. Okay. Time, random variable, and type of random process. Just a second, guys. Just a second. So if time is continuous and random variable is also continuous, then that type of random process is called as continuous random process. Is it clear? If time is continuous and random variable is also continuous, then that type of random process is called as continuous random process. If time is discrete, or this I'll discuss. If time is continuous and random variable is discrete, then that type of random process is called as discrete random process. So all random processes have defined together, that's why. Okay, if time is discrete, see, there are only two possibilities, right? Time can be either continuous or discrete, and similarly random variable also can be continuous or discrete. Okay, so if time is continuous and random variable, sorry, if time is discrete and random variable is continuous, then that type of random process is called as continuous random sequence. Continuous random sequence. So why sequence? Can someone tell me why it is sequence? It is sequence because time is discrete. In signals and systems, you might be studying now, whenever time is a discrete thing, then the signal, we will not call that as a signal, rather we will call that as a sequence, right? If both time and random variables are discrete, then that is called as a discrete random sequence. Okay, so this is the classification of random processes. Okay, just a sec, I'm just finishing it. Yes. So these are the different, these are the four different types of random processes that we'll be studying. Okay. So the first one, as I was saying, is continuous random process. So for a continuous random process, both the time and random variable are continuous. Okay. If time is continuous and random variable is discrete, then that type of random process is called as discrete random process. Okay. And when time is discrete and random variable is continuous, then that is called as continuous random sequence. And if both are discrete, then that is called as discrete random sequence. Okay, so whenever you see like time is discrete, then the random process is nothing but a sequence, because time discrete, no? So whenever time is discrete in nature, then we will not be calling that as a signal, rather we'll be calling that as a sequence, right? And so on. And whenever a random variable is discrete, okay, that process is actually discrete process, and so on. Okay, this is the way you have to understand. Then we'll see how the time functions looks like for each and every random process. Let me repeat. Now we will be seeing how does the time functions looks like for every random process. Okay. First one. So what's the first one? The first one is continuous random process, right? So how does the time functions looks like? That we'll see now.
Sir?
Yeah, any doubt?
So in previous table, instead of random variable, can we use sample space word?
I strictly say no, you have to use random variable only, because as I've shown in the previous, in yesterday's class, we have discussed, right? If it is two-dimensional quantity, and if you freeze time, then what you get is x of s, right? So whenever a quantity which is varying only with respect to sample space, we call that as a random variable. And hence I have written this one as random variable. You can use the sample space here, but there are small intricacies here. If you remember when we were discussing about classification of random variables, yeah, here it is. We have discussed about classification of random variables, right? At that time, we have seen small cases, right? Like if sample space is continuous, okay, if sample space is continuous, then the random variable, can it be continuous or it can be discrete also? Can you tell me? Are you there?
Yes, sir.
492. The question that I am asking is, how do we get a random variable? Random variable is actually a mapping from the sample space onto the real axis, right?
Yes, sir.
The question that I am asking is, based on the sample space, we actually define whether the random variable is continuous or discrete. That's fine. But my question is, if the sample space is continuous, then can we get a discrete random variable, or we will get only continuous random variable, or we can get both? That's my question.
Sir, both, I think both, sir.
No, for this, to answer this question, you have to understand or you should remember one topic, that is actually called as, what are the conditions for a function to become a random variable?
Yes, sir, we have three conditions.
Yeah, what are they?
Sorry.
Okay, the first condition says it should not be multi-valued, right? What happened? Are you there? Am I disconnected? Are you there? Hello?
Sir?
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
No, we are actually... slightly deviating from... But since you have asked, I have to answer. Let me answer. Yes, I'm here. It should not be multi-valued, right? Which means every point in the sample space must correspond to only one value of the random variable. Okay, so this is what I mean by multi-valued. So it should not be a multi-valued function. Then by using just a second, guys. Are you able to see the PDF?
Yes, sir.
The classification of random variables topic.
Yes, sir.
You are able to see, right? Huh.
Yes.
Yes. So here, if you see, the sample space for a discrete random variable, it can be discrete or continuous.
Yes, sir.
Right? Yeah, but for continuous, it has to be continuous only. The reason being, if I consider discrete sample space and if I think about continuous random variable, then we might not we might, then we will be assigning multiple values for a single outcome of the sample space. In that case, the function is going to be multi-valued function, and hence it is not going to be a random variable. Are you getting what I'm saying? Whenever we think of defining a continuous random variable using a discrete sample space, then the function is becoming a multi-valued function, and hence that is not going to be a random. That's not going to be a random variable. The question, the point I'm trying to tell you is, if I write a sample space instead of the random variable there, then the sample space, it can be continuous or discrete for discrete random variable, right? For discrete random variable, the function, the sample space can be either discrete or continuous also, right? But when I, So here, if I write sample space, okay, then if I write continuous here, then the random variable, whether it is continuous or discrete, that I don't know. Right?
Yes, sir.
So that's the reason it is always good if you write random variable here.
Okay, I understand. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Let us see how does the time functions looks like for every type of random process. So the first one is continuous random process. So you can see here that for a continuous random process, both the time and random variable are, both time and random variable are continuous. And one thing I have to tell you here itself, time is on the x-axis and random variable is on the y-axis. Why I'm saying that random variable is on the y-axis? It is because when do we get random variable? Random variable is obtained when, if you freeze random process at a particular instant of time, right? So a random process becomes a random variable when the time is fixed at a particular point, right? Which means if you remember the diagram that I drew, if you draw one dotted line at t equal to t1, okay, so the random process is becoming a random variable there. The value of y is which means random variable values are plotted on the y-axis and time values are plotted on the x-axis. Okay. Now, how does a time function looks like? It can be, one thing I have to tell you, these are all random signals. There is no reason why I drew values like this. The shape of the signals can be random in nature. You are free to use any one shape. It's up to you, okay? This is again one more time function, and this is xn plus 2 of t. The reason why I have drawn, why I wrote xn plus 1 or xn plus 2 is because I don't know how many points are there in the sample space, okay? So they are continuing and they will continue. Excuse me. This is xn plus 3 of t and it goes on. Okay. Do you get what I'm saying? I'm saying that in the sample space, there can be many points. Okay. So, and hence I just have written xn plus 1, xn plus 2, xn plus 3, and so on. So, here if you see on the time axis, clearly you can see that time is continuous here. What about y-axis? How many levels are there on the y-axis? Can someone tell me? You are reading the signals and systems, no? You should be able to tell now. How many values are there on the y-axis? How many levels are there on the y-axis?
Dick.
Huh? How many levels are there, man, on the y-axis? Just a sec. Yeah, tell me, how many levels are there on the y-axis? You are reading signals and systems subject, you should tell me. Infinite, right? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Why you people are struggling? How many levels are there here on the y-axis? For this particular function, how many levels are there on y-axis?
Discontinuity is another. Three.
Three, sir.
Three, yeah. What are they? Let us say this is minus one and this is plus one. What is the third level? Minus 1 is one level, plus 1 is one level. What is the third level? Discontinuity and two different kada.
Marindi kada location.
Okate kada discontinuity undi.
Pike pine vadmani. Valaku ala telustadi. Endukante
there are only two levels here. One is minus 1 or plus 1. Why? It is because at any point of time if you observe the signal, there are only the signal will be either in this level or this level. Maybe I'll draw this way. You see this particular signal, observe this for some time. At any point of time, if you see this signal is either in the minus one level or plus one level, yes or no? Which means this is discrete. I am not saying discrete signal, please follow carefully. I am saying that with respect to y-axis it has two levels only. Okay, no, I should not say discrete because you will be confusing. With respect to y-axis it has only two levels. Okay, what about just a sec, what about this particular signal? Can someone tell me? Some x of t. How many levels are there here? Guys, please.
Infinite.
Infinite, right? Anyone has any doubts? It has infinite number of levels. Yes, very good. Because with respect to y-axis, if you see, it has many levels. It can be like 0.01 or 0.0005, or it can be minus 0.999. okay, so all the levels are quite possible here because it's continuous here, right? So that's the reason. If you see first case, continuous random process, with respect to y-axis, is it continuous or discrete there? it is continuous because for every time instant the signal value is defined. I'll tell you again why I am saying that, why I am saying time is continuous here, because for every time instant, for every t, signal value is defined, whether it can be zero or plus or minus, whatever, but for every time instant the signal, I mean xn plus 1 or xn plus 2 or xn plus 3 or whatever, all the time functions are defined for every time instant, which means time is continuous here. Time is continuous. Same is the case with random variable also. If you see y-axis, there are infinite number of levels, and hence this particular thing is a continuous random process. Now what I draw now is discrete random process. Discrete random process. Okay, so for a discrete random process, time is continuous and random variable is discrete, right? Now can someone tell me how does the time functions looks like? It's very easy. So time has to be what? Time has to be continuous and random variable has to be discrete, which means with respect to y-axis, it has to be discrete, right? Yes. You look at this particular time function and tell me whether time is continuous or not here. Time is continuous here because for every time instant, the signal is clearly defined, right? And what about y-axis? Is it continuous or discrete? It is discrete because at any point of time, if you see, the signal is either in this level or this level, which means random variable is discrete here. And to be specific, it has only two levels. So discrete means what? It can be countable. 1 or 2 or 3 or 4 or 5. I should be able to count the number of levels and tell you. Okay. So this has random variable is discrete here and time is continuous here. And this is an example of discrete random process. And always whenever you draw random process, you should draw at least three time functions and then you put dot dot dot. It says that it is a collection of the time functions. Guys, are you following what I'm saying? What I'm saying is random process is a collection of the random, a collection of many random time functions. And then so you should always draw at least 2 to 3 time functions and then you should put dot 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 here, like what I did here. Then only it feels, it looks like this is a collection of many time functions and that is a random process. Okay. So this is again one more time function, and this is again one more time function. So as I was saying, there is no reason why I draw like this. Okay. It's just some random signal, but you should put dots here. Okay. So this is the second type of random process, which is discrete random process. Okay. The third one is continuous random sequence. So for a continuous random sequence, what time is continuous or discrete? time is discrete, but random variable is continuous. Okay, so which means it is, you can think of the discrete random continuous random sequence as a sampled version of this particular case. A sampled version of this particular case. I hope you know what do you mean by sampling. Okay, if not, I'll draw anyway. So time has to be what? Maybe I think I should write here itself. Just a sec, guys. Just a sec. Time is continuous and random variable is also continuous. What about here? Here, time is continuous and random variable is discrete here. Okay. And what about here? Time is discrete here and random variable is continuous. Am I right? This is what I've told you, right? Time is discrete and random variable is continuous. Okay. So yes. So time has to be discrete, which means that typical time function, it looks like the following. Okay, so maybe I say xn plus 1 of t. So you can see here that the signal is defined, I mean to say the time function is defined only for specific instance of time. Maybe I'll use some other color here. This particular time function is defined only at the time instance at which I'm using, wherein I have used pink color. Okay. So the moment you see this, you should understand that this particular time function is not continuous. Rather, it is discrete in nature because the signal or the time function is defined only at specific instance of time only. Okay. And hence, this is an example of discrete time signal, discrete time signal. Okay. Now you can clearly see here that time is discrete here. What about the y-axis? I mean, what about the random variable here? Is it continuous or discrete? It is continuous because the number of levels on the y-axis, they are not fixed here. They are infinite here because the signal itself is like, it's continuously varying with respect to y-axis I'm talking. Okay. I'm talking with respect to the y-axis. Y-axis is still continuous in nature and hence the random variable is continuous, but time is discrete here. Am I clear, guys? Please carefully understand carefully observe the graphs. This is some other time function. Okay, so here also maybe you use some other color, which will just say that the signal or the time function is defined only at specific instance of time, which means this is a discrete time signal. Okay, I should not say signal here because I am discussing about random processes. It's a discrete time function. Okay. And y-axis, if you see, still it is continuous in nature because the number of levels on the y-axis are still infinity. Okay. And then this is a perfect example for continuous random sequence, or in other words, discrete time and continuous random variable random process. The fourth and final type is discrete random sequence. So a discrete random sequence, you can think of that as a sampled version of discrete random process that we have seen the second type. So this one, if you sample, what you get is a discrete random sequence, because for a discrete random sequence, time has to be discrete, and random variable also has to be discrete here. Okay. So some typical time functions, they looks like the following. This is time, and this is x n plus 1 of t. So you can see here, okay, that the signal is defined only at specific instance of time. What are they? They are marked with pink color here, which means this particular time function is defined only at specific instance of time, which means time is discrete here. And what about the y-axis? Is it continuous or discrete? Clearly, you can see here that y-axis is discrete here, because at any point of time, this particular time function is either in the positive level or negative level. That's it. Either in plus one or in minus one. That's it. It's not going to be in any other level. And hence, the y-axis is also discrete here. Am I clear? So that's how you can typically draw one time function, okay? And I'm telling you again, there is no reason why I am drawing in this particular fashion only. You can draw in your own convenient and interested way, okay? So this is x n plus 2 of t. Here also the function is defined only at specific instance of time, and at any point, if you see, the signal is going to be only in one of the two levels, and hence y-axis is also discrete here. Okay, so it's a perfect example for a collection of many time functions, or in other words, a collection of many it's a perfect example for discrete random sequence. So whenever you say sequence, time has to be discrete in nature. See, a discrete means it need not to be two levels. It can be three levels also. It can be four levels also. Okay. Just for simplicity, I am drawing it in two levels. That's it. This is x n plus 3 of t. Okay, again, here also the function is defined only at specific instance of time, and number of levels on the y-axis are also finite, two only. Okay, so that's about the classification of random processes. Is that clear? Any doubts? If you have any doubts, please ask me. If not, I'll start the next topic. Please look at the diagrams. no doubts. Okay, I'll just discuss one definition and then I'll stop. Do you have any extra classes in the afternoon? Any extra classes in the afternoon?
No, sir, we don't have.
Don't have, right? Okay. I'll try to schedule a class. Okay. Maybe 3 o'clock. Is it fine?
Sir, for C section students, we have 2:30 GS class.
GS class is there. Okay. I'll speak with sir, and if he says okay, I'll schedule a class. Okay. Okay, fine. next topic is the difference between deterministic and non-deterministic random processes. What do you mean by, it's a simple definition only, deterministic and non-deterministic. Non deterministic random processes. Can you tell me what do you mean by deterministic? Deterministic itself says that if you are able to, okay, so what's a random process actually? Random process is a collection of or group of, or family of, or ensemble of, whatever, okay? A collection of many time functions, right? Many time functions. Here is a trick, okay? So if you take any particular time function, okay, so in the previous diagrams you have drawn xn plus 1 of t, xn plus 2 of t, xn plus 3 of t, and so on, right? So even in the definition of the random process also, I have drawn many time functions, x1 of t, x2 of t, x3 of t. So they're all time functions. But the point is, if you are able to, okay, if you are able to predict the value of time function, then that is going to be a deterministic random process. And if you are not able to predict the time function value, okay, then that is going to be a non-deterministic random process. Maybe I'll show you this diagram. Here, if you see this xn plus 1 of t, okay, so it appears like it's completely a random signal, which means this is an example of, this is an example of non-deterministic random process. Why it is non-deterministic? It is because of the fact that I cannot determine what is the value taken by this particular time function at some time instant, which means I'll just tell you, let us say at t equal to 20 seconds, what is the value of x1 of t? What is x1 of t at t equal to 20 seconds? If you are able to tell exactly, then that process is going to be a deterministic process, because I am able to determine the value taken by the time function. Okay. Even it can be t equal to 20 seconds or t equal to 100 minutes, whatever. Okay. So on the time axis, at any point of time, just a sec, on the time axis, at any point of time, if I am able to tell you what is the value taken by the time function exactly, then that is going to be a deterministic random process. Am I clear, guys? One example I can give you is A cos omega t. Okay, A cos omega t. Let us say this is one of the time functions. Now you see here, you tell me any time instant, okay, for a given value of A and omega, you tell me any time instant, I can exactly tell you what is the value taken by x1 of t. Yes or no? because this x1 of t is clearly a well-defined mathematical function. And hence, you tell me any time instant, which means t equal to 20 or 30 or 40 or 29, whatever may be, okay? At any time instant, I can predict what is the value taken by the time function. Yes or no? Which means this is an example of deterministic random process. Am I clear? And what is a non-deterministic? It's exactly opposite of that. So the behavior of the time functions is purely random in nature, and we cannot predict what is the value taken by the time function. Such kind of random processes are called as non-deterministic random processes. Am I clear? Deterministic random process. Is that clear, guys? That's the definition of non-deterministic and deterministic. Okay. Deterministic means I should be able to exactly tell you, I should be able to tell you what is the value taken by the time function, okay, at any point of time. That's a deterministic random process. And non-deterministic is exactly opposite of that. Okay. I cannot predict what is the value taken by the time functions. Why I'm talking about time functions? It's simple. A random process is nothing but a collection of many time functions, and hence I am talking about the time functions. So if a time function is clearly a well-defined mathematical function without any probability terms, then that's going to be a deterministic random process. And for non-deterministic random process, even though it has mathematical structure, but if probabilities are involved there, then that's going to be non-deterministic random process. Okay. So with this, I'll stop for now. Okay. I'll see whether I can take an extra class. Okay. If provided, if there is no meeting, definitely I'll take a class. Okay. So any doubts? If not, I'll stop. No. Okay, thank you.